Good morning. Thank you for letting me into your house. This morning we're just going to praise and worship together, and I'm going to do my best just to stay out of the way and sing with me. I'm going to sing with you. I'm going to start you off with a song that I haven't done here before, but I really like it because of what the words say, that I'm here to be with God. And you're going to learn it really quick and then sing with me. I'm here.
Savior God to thee, how great thou art.
God's bearing sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great the thank you.
I read a cute story the other day that talks a lot about what we're going to be sharing today. A kindergarten teacher was getting everybody ready to try to get out the door at the end of the day, and a little boy was just having the dickens of a time getting his boots on. So she bent over and was helping him get his boots on, and one boot finally got on, the other boot finally got on. She just about broke a sweat. She was working so hard. The boots are on, and the little boy leaned over and said, "Teacher, they're on the wrong feet." But she didn't say anything. She smiled and was very pleasant. She wrestled the boots off, which actually was harder than trying to get the boots on. So she finally got the boots off, finally got them back on the right feet. And this was taking a lot of time, a lot of energy. She no sooner gets the last boot on when the little boy looked at her and said, "These aren't my boots." Again, smile. Inside, she's kind of screaming like, "Why didn't you tell me?" But she smiled and helped get those boots off. Took the same amount of work to get them off. She got the last boot off and on the floor. He looks at her and he says, "Well, these are my brother's boots. My mom made me wear them today." Okay, so she's still got that not as genuine smile, but she's trying for it. She gets the little boy's boots back on him and think, "Ah, we're all ready to go. This is wonderful." And then it was cold outside, so she said, "Okay, now where are your mittens?" He says, "I stuffed them into the toes of my boots." I don't know about you, but that lady had more patience than I would. I think I'd have lost it about two pairs earlier. And I think, you know, we've all felt like this teacher, being a bit impatient. And this morning, as we continue in Haggai, we're going to be looking again at the rebuilding of the temple by God's people who have come back from captivity in Persia. I found a couple of cartoons that I thought were kind of fun. This one says, "You're never going to get to work on time." So how many of you have been stopped in traffic? And at least this sign is honest about it. Hey, you're going to be late. That has a snail riding on a turtle. The snail is saying, "Whee!" And it's a snail extreme sports. Okay. That would need patience too, wouldn't it? I like this one. Road closed here Monday, June 3rd for 15 years. I don't know about you, but I've come across a few construction projects that seemed about like that too. This last one's my favorite. This guy is in the doctor's office. He's been waiting for his appointment. And needless to say, it took a little longer than what he thought. So again, I think we've always been at that situation. This morning, the people of in Haggai's time were frustrated. When chapter 2 opens, a month has elapsed between chapter 1 and chapter 2. And things aren't quite going as people expected. So let's take a look at the scripture. And it says, "On the 21st day of the 7th month, the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Speak to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, to Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people. Ask them, who of you is left that saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? But now be strong, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord, and work. For I am with you, declares the Lord Almighty. This is what I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, and my spirit remains among you. Do not fear." See, the people were frustrated because they were working for an entire month, 50,000 people, in addition to working on their own houses and their own crops and everything. And the house of the Lord, they didn't look like they had anything done. Of course, it took a long time to get the rubble out of there and to get everything cleared off to where they could lay foundations and everything. And when God is asking these questions, he asks, you remember the splendor of the old temple? It sounds at first glance like God may be scolding them, when actually he isn't. He's just saying to them, it's okay. It's okay. You see, they were in bondage, they were in captivity for 70 years. That means when they were taken away to Persia, somebody who would say be my granddaughter's age, Allie, she's gonna be 2 in October. And so if you put her on that timeline, she would be coming back to that land as a 72-year-old woman. And she would have been brought up with the idea of being in captivity. The older kids would have remembered the temple and seen the temple and marveled at its glory. And then they come back and it's destroyed. I imagine to be that way if somebody experienced a house fire. And certainly this time of year, we see a lot of tornadoes and things like that happen around the country, and houses are just obliterated. And it's a terrible thing when you remember it in its glory, and now it just looks like a pile of kindling. And so the people were just frustrated. They had been working really, really hard, and you just don't have a lot to show about it. And also, the nation of Judah was having a problem with their festivals and their feast. It was three festivals that would be happening right at this time. The Feast of Trumpets, the Day of Atonement, and the Feast of Tabernacles. This was kind of the Christmas, 4th of July, New Year's, the big three that you would choose for our lives. Those three were happening just about at the same time, and there were times for family to get together and celebration, certainly worship at the temple and how wonderful that would be. And yet all of those things weren't going to be able to happen, or they would be just a bit different. The reason I titled this sermon Pat in the Back instead of Pat on the Back is because God is doing more here than just giving them an attaboy or just a pat on the back like we would naturally do. He's really talking about, them on the inside, and that he had had this covenant relationship that he would help them build this temple. And he has not forgotten that covenant, that he was still going to be with him. And actually, the basis of the temple would be, as Jesus did many, many years later, when he's on the cross, we remember those last two words that he said, it is finished. And what a joy that is. It's a joy when a construction project is done. It's a joy when if you're writing something, I like to write poetry and things, and when it's done and looks just exactly how I would like it. It's great when somebody's cooking something and the dinner is ready and it came out perfect and tastes great. There's a great sense of satisfaction. That's what God was trying to build into the people here. I think that this message is so key for where we are today, and especially the idea that the festivals and all the things that the people were going through would look a lot differently. Candidly, in our culture today, with the coronavirus, things are happening different. You're watching me on a tape instead of, or on a streaming, I should say, instead of in the sanctuary gathered with people. Now, we may do this again, you know, after we get back together, and that's certainly the goal, but it just feels differently. I'm preaching this on Thursday afternoon, which is fine. Problem is that tomorrow morning I get up and I think it's Monday when actually it's Friday. And so everything has been goofed up. Talked to a lot of people who say, wow, one day just seems like the next. And everything is different. I've been talking about working a church camp this summer, and it may or may not take place. People are scheduling weddings, and they're going to have to look different as maybe they did weddings before, funerals and other occasions as well. And we feel that the future is uncertain, and also what everything that goes around us is changing every few minutes, and that's difficult to face. One question that always seems to be asked, and people asked it in the Old Testament, they asked it in the New Testament, they ask it today. That question is very simply this: why is God doing this to us? Why is this happening? Where is God in the middle of all of this? Well, I'd like us to turn to the New Testament here in the book of James. And in James chapter 1, verse 1, I don't have it here on the screen for you, but verse 1 says, consider it all joy, brethren, when you encounter trials of many kinds, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and that endurance will have its perfect reward, that you will be complete and lacking in nothing. And he builds on that point in this verse I have up here. When tempted, no one should say that God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they're dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. So what does that mean? It means simply that we go through trials and temptations. Now, especially in the book of James, he uses the words interchangeably. We tend to put trials as being something we're going through right now with a virus that's changing our life, and a temptation is maybe something as simple as I'm trying to be on a diet and I walk right by the donut shop and, you know, the bakery in town here where those maple bars can tempt anybody. But he uses them interchangeably. Why? Because, and not so much the maple bars, but temptations to do something wrong or say something wrong or think something wrong, and trials function in the same way. Satan can use the trials in our lives and the areas where we are most tempted to draw us away from God. And that's Satan's main purpose, is if we belong to Christ, to try to draw us away from a good relationship with him. Somebody doesn't know Christ, to keep them as far away as possible. God allows these trials so that our faith can strengthen, and it helps people not only to turn to God, but to trust him and follow him closely. I didn't put it up here, but I'm reminded of the Psalm 23. It's a familiar psalm. Yeah, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I fear no evil, for you are with me. Now, the valley of the shadow of death, certainly it talks about death, and that's why Psalm 23 is read a lot at funerals. But it's also an idea of when we're going through, I would say right now, really qualifies as a valley of the shadow of death. In other words, the path that the sheep were walking, it's dark and it's narrow and it's curvy, and they can't really see what's going on, and they're frightened, and they simply have to listen to the voice of the shepherd, and with his long staff, he can straighten them out, literally, and keep them in a straight line. And the rod, which is shorter, if some creature comes across their path, those guys were pretty good aim and could just zap it and take care of it. I firmly believe, folks, that today we're walking through a valley of the shadow of death. But we got to remember that next line. I fear no evil, for you are with me. And God guides us. And I think as Christians, we fall into the trap of, oh, when everything gets back to normal, or, oh, what does the future holds? In the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil today as I'm walking through it. In other words, God gives us the strength for today. Let me we find this reflected. Let me just quote this scripture real fast. Philippians 4:13, I can do how many things? All things. I can go through a virus. I can survive through economic difficulties. I can have courage when maybe I can't see my family as much as I would like to. I can do all things. How? Because I read a course on self-empowerment? No. I can do all things through Christ, who does what? Gives me strength. Jesus Christ, present in creation, God in human flesh, He knows us, He knows our limits, and He doesn't allow us to be tempted or tried beyond what we are able. Now that's the verse we always quote, but we forget the last part of it, that says He will always provide a way so that we can stand up under it. You ever been on a tall ladder? Yesterday, my wife decided she wanted to try to bake some bread, which is wonderful. We haven't done that in a while, and we have a bread maker. Great, where is it? It's up on this tall shelf. And inside we have kind of a smaller ladder, and I could have went out and got the 7-foot ladder in the garage, but I didn't feel like it, so what do? I get out the smaller ladder, and I'm climbing up on the top there, and though I am 6 feet tall, I was right about the edge, and it would have been great if that bread maker had been about 2 pounds, but it was a lot more than 2 pounds, and I'm just, ugh. And Joni had hold of that ladder, and I think part of my leg too, trying to help me and keep me stable until I could get that heavy bread maker down. That's what God does for us. Sometimes we feel outstretched. Sometimes we feel like we're really at the end. And God is holding the ladder. He's got us strong. He holds us, Isaiah tells us, in His righteous right hand. I want to share with you a poem. I want to share with you a poem that candidly, I do use this one at funerals, but as I was looking at it today, I saw that it really has a promise for other times like this, that Valley of the Shadow of Death. Annie Johnson Flint wrote it many years ago. It's entitled, God Has Not Promised. So I'll read it slow. We can think of the words. God has not promised skies always blue. Well, we live in Oregon. We know that. Flower-strewn pathways all of our life through. God has not promised sun without rain, joy without sorrow, peace without pain. But God has promised strength for the days, rest for the labor, light for the way, grace for the trials, help from above, unfailing sympathy, undying love. So in the midst of everything that we are going through today, and for the things that God has brought us through in the past, and it could be financial difficulties, and it could be physical illness, it can be situational problems, whatever they may be, God has promised rest and strength and grace every single day. We remember how Peter walked on the water. Remember the passage in the Gospels? And Jesus is walking on the water out to them in the middle of the night. That would be a little interesting, I imagine. And so the disciples were, it's a ghost, what do we do? And Jesus said, fear not. It is I. Do not be afraid. Well, 11 of the disciples calmed right down. Peter, who had a habit of sticking his foot in his mouth, said, Lord, if it is you, command me to come out there and walk with you on the water. Now, if that had been me, it's a good thing I'm not Jesus, but if I'd have been Jesus, Peter, you just fool yourself. All you do is talk about yourself. Just stay in the boat and relax. Nope, he said, you want to come walk? Sure, come on. So Peter hops out of the boat, and guess what? He's walking on the water. And the text is funny because it doesn't tell us how long Peter was out there. It's like, you know, half an inch in our Bible, so it must have happened right away. I don't know. I think Maybe Peter was walking around there, took a little break, looked at some fish down there, who knows. But all of a sudden he started seeing the waves splashing up on his feet, and he began to feel the wind. And instead of holding on to the hand of Jesus, and instead of looking in his face, he looks down at the waves. And the joke was, when I was in Israel in 1999 studying over there for a few weeks, when we were all at the Sea of Galilee at that spot, we can say we walked where Jesus walked. And in some cases, we swam where Jesus walked. And the Sea of Galilee is 700 feet deep, or 451 feet deep in its deepest spot. And Peter, whoop, heading down to the bottom, Jesus grabbed him, held him up. Why did you doubt, ye of little faith? And we're walking on the waves here, man, I'll tell you what. But as long as we keep our eye on the Master and our hand in his, he will watch over us. True story. In 1998, Harvard senior class, they gathered in Memorial Church as the minister was sharing a baccalaureate, and which was kind of combined along with their graduation program and exercises. And he offered word of solace and encouragement as they left the yard to take their place in the world. And so Peter Gnomes, who is the professor of Christian morals, he says this: "You're going to be sent out of here for good, and most of you aren't ready to go." You ever felt that way? I have. You are not ready to go. The president is about to bid you into the fellowship of educated men and women, and you all know just how dumb you really are. And the senior class got a laugh at that. And he said, worse than that, the world and your parents in particular are going to expect that you will be among the brightest and best. But you know that you can no longer fool all the people, even some of the time. By noon today, you'll be out of here. By tomorrow, you're going to be history. By Saturday, you'll be toast. And that's a fact. No exceptions, no extensions. He paused for a moment to let the words sink in, and everybody was thinking, wait a minute, this is supposed to be a happy occasion. What's going on? Well, he continued. He said, nevertheless, there is reason to hope. The future is God's gift to you. God will not let you stumble or fall. He has not brought you this far to this place to abandon you or leave you alone and afraid. The God of Israel never stumbles, never sleeps, never goes on sabbatical. Thus, my beloved and bewildered young friends, don't be afraid. And I think those graduation words are very appropriate for today. Do not be afraid. God says in Isaiah, I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will hold you in my righteous right hand. Trust in God today. Hold on to him. He will never, ever let go of you.